So what do you eat for the next 2 days until like after the weighing?
I'm still good. Today in the morning I had some oatmeal with some berries from down the street here, from two shops down. Very good oatmeal with strawberries, blueberries. Then I had some shrimp ceviche cocktail for lunch earlier before coming here. I'm good. I'm drinking a lot of water still. We're good. Tomorrow morning we'll check where I am on weight. And most likely just rest. Try to rest the entire day. Have some light meals. And at night, probably hit it here. Drop, you know, a pound or two of weight. That's it. We're
weigh-in time.
Friday is the weigh-in. You know?
Well, one thing the UFC does, which I just caught on to it, the UFC weighs the fighters in the hotel at 10 a.m.
10 a.m.
And then they do a show for the fans at 4 p.m.
Really?
Yeah.
Is that right?
They weigh them at 10 in the hotel, and at 4 p.m. they show
up. The commission does that?
Yeah. They allowed them to do it in Vegas. Because I was wondering, how do you make a fighter wait till 4 p.m. and, you know, they're starving? The fighters told me, Ellie, we do it at the hotel at 10 a.m.
10 a.m., they weigh in, check in.
And they're good for the rest of the day?
They're good. So then when they go do the show, it's
just a show. Yeah, yeah, yeah. They're just flexing.
But they don't have a scale there, like, to check, or it's fixed? Just to make it
It's fixed.
Like
it's just for show.
It's for show? Well, I don't know that. It makes it easy for them.
Yeah, it makes it easy.
But some of them guys kill themselves, they too, do. Man. Because the weights... The schedule, the divisions are further apart.
Yeah.
So they kill themselves either to drop weight or drop 10 pounds different. And they really, really kill themselves. So I guess for that reason, it helps those kind of guys. Either they're too small for the division north or they starve themselves and kill themselves to make that division.
They do it, you're right. I know fighters have done that.
Yeah,
but
yeah. I mean, we do it too. Fighters do it too, where you kill yourself, you know, but... It's I think it's harder for them because the divisions are that much further apart. There's less divisions.
You're right.
Like with me right here, you know, 126, you know, and then 130, and then 135. They're, you know, 4 pounds of difference or whatever between them. You know, 140, they're all about 4 or 5 pounds. You go to smaller weight classes like we were talking about. You know, in a 10-pound difference, you go through like 4 different weight classes.
Hey, Chicolatito's fighting for the 150 title. He's already. And
I'm
a 4-division champion
right now.
4-division?
Yeah.
And he's
108.
105.
105.
108.
112. 112.
Hey, I think Carlos will beat him. Carlos Quadras.
That'd be nice.
I think he'll beat that.
In 10 pound difference from 105, 108, 112, 115. He's going through 4 divisions. You know, you don't have that in the UFC.
No. But one thing the UFC did, Nick Diaz, the brother of Nate Diaz, he went to Toronto to fight George St. Pierre.
Nick?
Nick. George St. Pierre couldn't make weight. It was for the championship. Yeah. On the spot, they said, okay, the new weight for the championship is 162, 160. Because it's their own commission. They own. They make their own rules.
That's some fighters do that too.
That's something fighters do that. Make their own divisions.
Yep.
Man, I should do that too then. Shit.
Robert Ford, 126, right?
30.
130.
Pro at like 22, 24.
You turned pro at 22?
23, somewhere.
And then you moved up to 26 and 30?
He was at 26, but then he got a North American title fight at 130, right?
Yep.
And that's what he did. So he stayed at 130, but he was fighting at 26, and good opportunity to fight for the NABF title at 130 came up, and he stayed there. He was champion at 130 later.
How would he do today if he was active today with whoever's at 130 right now?
At 130?
Yeah.
He beats him.
How about 135?
35. Did you fight 135? Like once or twice?
No, once.
Once,
no? I did one, my last fight.
Yeah. Yeah, he was too small for the 135.
Him and Lomachenko, good fight?
Get some experience.
Lomachenko's a real deal.
Okay, how about him and, what's the name, Fernando Vargas? No, Francisco Vargas.
Francisco Vargas.
Robert would be him. Salido,
you and Floyd, that would have been the fight. What if Robert would have been the one?
Oh, he would have, but Robert, They were there to look and maybe talk about a fight. At that time, Robert was champion in And they were looking either for Jaime moving up. The Prince was either going to move up to 130 or maybe a fight with Floyd, you know, stuff like that, but it never happened.
I think the closest guy to beat Floyd for me was Maidana. The first fight.
Yeah.
It was very close.
Very close. If that fight would have been called even a draw, people would have taken it as a way to help Floyd. Nobody would have argued that decision. That's why they made a rematch. It was that close.
And the rematch, Floyd won.
Floyd, you know, boxed differently, and the referee also helped a lot.
And I say that was your fault.
You got.
Because you sparred Maidana before.
It happens.
I know. And he made $11 million, so hey, everybody wins. But yeah, the referee in the second fight, different style of refereeing.
Yeah, completely different. Wouldn't allow let Maidana work on the inside. As soon as he was close, he would separate him without even, you know, letting him give him a chance to fight. So completely took Maidana out of his game plan. Protein shake, Robert.
Yeah. I'm gonna get him right now.
What about that?